As we get into the Word today, I want to talk about something I think many of us have been exposed to or familiar with. Have you ever asked God for something? Have you ever prayed for something? Have you ever noticed that it doesn't always happen and typically does not happen overnight? And have you ever noticed that when you are praying and believing for something that rightfully belongs to you from the Word of God, there is pressure that will come against you that you didn't know was going to be coming against you to try to keep you from the promise? Today, we're going to talk about how to stand strong, having done all, to withstand pressure of the enemy so that you can receive your promise that God has for you. Not settle for what you're dealing with, but to know that if God said it to you, He meant it for you, and you can have it on this side of eternity. Let's begin with prayer. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to be in your presence. We thank you for your anointing. We thank you for your truth. And Lord, I hold up every person under the sound of my voice, wherever they're at in their walk with you, wherever they are at in their journey of life, touch their heart. I pray for wisdom and understanding, that anointing that brings insight so that we can know your goodness, your power that's available to us who believe. We give you praise. We sanctify this place with the precious blood of Jesus, and we thank you for your presence here today. And everybody said, amen, amen and amen. I'm going to do something that I haven't done in ages. I need three volunteers. I want three men to come up here and help me out. Okay, Ted, I knew you'd be one. I just had this visual. You were going to be one. Come to the side. I need two more. Come on, somebody. Two more men. All right, second, third. All right. Now you're changing your mind. You know, you're coming. Yeah, no. You know, I could think of the scripture about a double-minded person. Here he comes. Give him a big hand clap. How you doing, my friend? What's your name?
Matthew.
Everybody say hi to Matthew.
Hi, Matthew.
Ted.
Ted. Say hi to Ted.
Robert.
Say hi to Robert.
Hi, Robert.
I don't know about you, but I feel a little bit safer with these men behind me right now. Amen. All right. Come here. I want you to stand right here. I'm going to put you right there. We're going to put you right. You're good where you're at. You come here, Robert, and you can stand right here. Now, here, in the Bible, they're going to represent a few things for me today. In the Bible, in 2 Kings chapter 4, have you heard this verse before? And it talks about a widow woman. Her husband had died, leaving her with an enormous amount of debt. A lot of theologians believe that what he was one of the prophets, one of the sons of the prophets, and that he worked for the prophet of God. And the reason he was so much debt is the famine, and he was putting himself in debt to feed the other prophets. During the process of what seemed to be a really good idea, the guy shows up and he ends up dying, leaving her with this debt. And in that culture, in that time, you didn't have a bankruptcy option. They would come and take your children, put them into slavery. So here she is. She shows up to the prophet of God and says, my husband, your servant, is dead. And he is left us with debt, and the creditors have come to take my sons. And the prophet said, again, challenge everything I say with the word of God. The prophet said, what do I have? And she goes, help me out. And he said, what do you have? Say, what do you have? Couple things I want you to notice is that in the Old Testament, only three individuals or positions were anointed: the king, the priest, and the prophet. The king was anointed by God to bring the order and the rule of God into the world. That's why he fought wars. He was bringing order. The priest was anointed by God, and his role was to minister for the people to God. So he would go into the most holy place, is one of the jobs he had, to offer up the blood and sprinkle it onto the mercy seat for the sins of the people. So he was ministering from the position of from the people to God. The prophet was anointed by God to be the voice of God from heaven to earth. Now, we don't have a lot of time to go into this, but an Old Testament prophet is not the same as a New Testament prophet. Because in the Old Testament, the only way to find out what God was saying is you had to be a prophet or be around a prophet. New Testament, Jesus changed the whole thing and said, my sheep hear my voice. Come on, somebody. All right. So we're led by, the Bible says we're led by the Spirit, now led by prophets. There's still a place in the New Testament church for prophets, but it's different. So you're going to represent the prophet. The prophet was, again, God's word to people. So what she was doing, which we all should do, when we are in a situation and we're praying for something, and you are going to be what we are praying for, you are the promise. Say promise.
Promise.
You're doing a great job. So he's the. So when you are praying for the promise that you get from the word, she came to the word looking for direction. Some people don't go to the word. They start off on the negative because they are running into a problem. They need a promise, but they run from the word. Have you ever seen somebody? Where have you been? I haven't seen you in church in 3 months. Oh, I've been going through a hard time. If you go through a hard time, you need to be in church more, not less. And it's not based because you want to or feel it. You have to tell yourself, I need to be more. You got to saturate yourself with the word of God.
Now,
until it brings a place of peace. Can I get an amen?
Amen?
And so she was going to the word, and the word gave her direction and asked her, what do you have? Say, what do you have?
What do you have?
Many times people get stuck believing for a promise because all they see is what they've lost, not what they have. What is left is so important because God works with what is left, not what is lost. Come on, somebody. And so she said, I don't have anything. Human nature. Across the board, one story after other, when we deal with a problem and we're believing for a promise, what we have doesn't seem important. Right? When Jesus told the disciples, let's feed them. We can't feed them. That's a lot of money. What do you have? We have nothing but a little boy's lunch. God does the miracle with what is left,
Amen.
Not with what is lost.
Amen.
Say, God does the miracle with what is left. Not what is lost. So immediately he begins to re-clarify in her vision, her place, her identification, what she has. She says, I don't have anything but a little oil. And he's thinking, that's going to be good enough. Say, that's good enough.
That's good enough.
You ought to get in movies. You're a great actor. And so he is good. And so she was in a position of, okay, I'm going to take, and he began to give her direction. Say, direction. So she received identification. I'm throwing a lot at you quickly. And she began to receive direction. He said, take the oil. Now go borrow a bunch of vessels. Go in that room with your sons and begin to pour. And as she began to pour, the miracle began to happen. Why? Because she began to obey the instruction or the direction. Many times we've done stuff that didn't work, and God will ask us to do something that sounds the same just to see if we're willing to trust Him with the direction that comes from the Word. It's not just action, but it's direction from the Word. Let me give you another example. Didn't Peter throw, he toiled all night, and Jesus said, cast the net over. And Peter said, we have toiled all night, caught nothing. We have fished and caught nothing. But if you look at the King James, nevertheless, at your word. And he began to obey the word. My friend, don't obey the word from other people. Don't obey what other people have done. Get God's word for you on what you should do. Because faith comes by hearing the word of God. Clear, a little better translation, faith comes by hearing God for yourself. When you spend all your energy copying anybody and everybody, even if they have a book or on TV, because what they are dealing with is similar to what you're dealing with, you can exhaust yourself. And the devil doesn't mind you trying if you exhaust yourself trying to get to the promise. But we need to get the word from God. And the prophet said, do this. And it was borrowing that got her in debt in the first place. And it makes no sense to borrow more when you're in bankruptcy.
Right, right, right,
but that's why the Bible says, trust in the Lord with all your heart, lean not to your own understanding. Come on, somebody. In all your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will direct your path. And when God speaks to you to do it in your heart, Just not an idea in your head, but in your heart gives you revelation. You step it out because it might not ever work that way for you, Peter. It might not ever have happened for anybody else, Mary and Martha, when it comes to Lazarus. It might not, but when God tells you to do it. So notice she got identification, she got direction. Notice also on a side note, the prophet didn't go with her. The prophet didn't chase her. She realigned herself to the word. Many times we want to take the Bible and line it up to our situation. Well, I guess God doesn't do that anymore. I guess that died out with the early church. What is happening? They are running into an issue of life, trying to understand it, and instead of lining themselves up with the word of God, they try to bend the word to them.
Right.
When you fragment the word, it's like a seed. You get nothing out of it. Amen? And so back to our story. So here we are. The prophet says to the widow woman, I want you to go and to borrow. I want you to start pouring. And we know that in the story that as she obeyed, it multiplied. And then she did something really unique that most Christians don't ever do. In the process of victory, she came back to the word. Most people only come to God or prayer or church or the word in the pit. They don't come to him in the palace. But you need the word as much in the palace as you do the pit. Now, an interesting thing that she had to get redefined in her identification is because she was coming to the word or to the prophet to get the problem fixed. We typically go to God in prayer to get the problem fixed. But the prophet wasn't interested in just getting her problem fixed. He was more interested in getting her to the fulfillment of the promise. Because she's looking for, I'm in so much debt, I'm about to lose everything, help me. But when it was all said and done, he told her, take the oil, sell it, pay your debt, catch this, and live on all the rest. She came in the door looking for survival. She walked out the door looking to flourish. Come on, somebody. When you begin to pray and ask God, always line your prayers up to the promise. Because in the promise, that's where God's power's at. We tend to say, God, if you could just help me a little bit. God's not into a little bit of help. If you could just help me pay rent one more time at the end of the month. God's not trying to help you survive. He wants you to reach the fulfillment of the promise. It's the enemy. It's the enemy that will try to get you to embrace where you're at as if it will always be. But God doesn't want to help you just fulfill and fix the problem. He wants you to fulfill the promise. Wave over there, Mr. Promise. Thank you, sir. So the question now is, when I get a word from heaven, when I get a word from God, I begin to set my focus, my direction on obeying the direction.
Right.
But Matthew's Gospel, chapter 13, am I going too fast?
No.
It's just warm up. Matthew 13 and Mark 4 tells us that when the word comes, the direction, with the direction, as you begin to advance in it, comes this thing called pressure. Say pressure. Now, I love you, and you're a good man. He's a good man, but we're going to call him pressure today. So I get a word from God, in this case it was the prophet, about the promise, a direction for the promise. As I begin to obey it, pressure shows up and tries to keep me from the promise. This is where a lot of Christians get stuck. Now, you can push on me a little bit, right? I weigh more than 95. Not too hard now. No, don't start trying to impress people.
Too late.
Too late. Thank you. Is that called eye candy? Is that what she said? Okay, there you go. And so pressure is the place in our spiritual walk with God where it takes the toll for a lot of Christians, and they stop because of the pressure. Because when the promise comes, we know that the promise of faith comes from the Word. Romans 10, 17, faith comes by hearing and hearing the Word of God.
Amen.
We know that that faith, for us to access and receive it, it is just not by faith, it's by faith and patience. Hebrews 6, 12, Hebrews 11, 33. So when I get the direction, faith begins, but also the process of patience begins. It's not overnight. Say, it's not overnight.
It's not overnight.
I wish it was overnight.
Yeah.
I wish it was I heard from God and the next morning I woke up and it's just the way it should be. But have you noticed that even good people around you aren't always happy when you're happy?
Right, right.
And the devil will use people and situations and try to get in your imagination. Right. Why? To create pressure so that you never get to the promise. Mm-hmm. And what happens is we need to learn how to go from hearing the word and enduring and overcoming the pressure so that we can have what belongs to us, the promise. How do we do that? How do we do it? If you have your Bibles, we're going to go to Hebrews 12. A few more minutes and then you guys will, but you guys are doing good, by the way. Aren't they doing good? Hebrews 12 says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, right? So he's the one who starts it, and he's the one that completes it, the author and finisher. He's the author and finisher of our faith because faith comes by hearing the word, and John 1, 1 and verse 14 tells us that Jesus is also the word. Looking unto Jesus, not only as an example, but also for empowerment, right? Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him, what happened? He endured the cross. So for the joy set before him, he endured the cross.
Yes.
He endured the pressure of the situation because he had clarity, focus on the promise.
Yeah. Yeah. Amen. Amen.
For the joy set before him,
yeah,
he endured the cross.
Right.
Because he knew that even though the enemy was creating pressure to keep him back, there was a promise that he was going to. Have you ever been going someplace quickly and someone shows up for small talk? And you don't want to be rude and your brain's going, how do I get through this? Because I have a place to go. And finally, I've been in those situations, and finally, and I don't know if it's rude or not, I say, you know what, it's so good to see you. Hate to cut this short, but I have to go somewhere. As long as I know where I am going, mm-hmm, pressure, though it might tend to appear to delay me, can't keep me
right
from my promise.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Right?
Amen.
Right? Now, so what did Jesus do? He saw the joy set before him.
Yes.
He saw the promise.
Amen.
He saw what the Father was doing. He knew the plan. Let me give you a personal story. A few months ago, usually I wear glasses. A few months ago, I left my glasses at work, came back the next day, can't find them. You know what? I didn't leave them at work. Do you know where I left them? Anybody? Because I don't know. I can't find them. I can't find them. So I'm in the process of getting some new glasses. If Dr. Wicken would take my appointment, thank you, Jesus. No. And so the reason I wear glasses is because back in the day when I was in college, I spent so much time on the computer, it created some issues with clarity. Stay with me. And so I see clearly here. Clearly. But when it comes to distance, it's a little blurry. Stay with me.
Yeah.
So the farther out the promise is, because some promises can be farther out.
Yeah. Yeah.
Some of you are like, Lord, I don't even see the light at the end of the tunnel. He said, don't worry, there is light.
Yeah.
Because the entrance of his word gives
light.
You guys are good today. And so there's sometimes we're looking and we can't see the light of the tunnel. And it's because we don't have clarity of focus. The Bible says, and we have this in our notes, you could get this on the app, it tells us to set our affection on things above, not things on the earth. The word affection there also means to set our focus. But if my focus is off, I can't see what God is doing from afar. All I can see is what's near me, which is the temporal. And the thing with that is, because if my focus from distance is far, I don't look there, I only look around here. And when all I do is look at what's near me, my world becomes filled up with where I'm at,
right,
not where I'm going.
Right, right.
And I know you've never been that way, but maybe you'll come across people that all they are seeing is the moment, and as a result, they feed themselves on the moment. And like back in the day of computer programming days, it's called GIGO, G-I-G-O, garbage in, garbage out. What you Bible says, what you feed is going to make a difference, what you feed on. And so if I'm feeding on the temporary problem all the time, I'll begin to speak the problem. I'll begin to expect the problem. I begin to embrace the problem. I begin to expect nothing to change because all I see is the problem. Because I can't see with clarity the promise. Because my focus is not right. So what do I have to do? I had to go back and pull out some old glasses. Not the ones I lost, but the ones I had left behind.
All right.
And they're a little scratched. They're not the way that I want them to be. But you know what?
Yeah.
They work.
Yeah.
Stay with me. Yeah. The Bible tells me, and Jesus said it this way, that a person trained in the kingdom knows how to draw out of their spirit things that are new and things that are old. What we tend to do in the church world when we run into a problem, sometimes, not all the time, sometimes we are expecting a new direction for a new problem. And sometimes God's saying, no, there is times I want you to go back to some things you thought were old. Well, that's not so exciting. God, tell me something to do. I want you to do this. Well, that's not, you know, I heard some people, you were telling them to do some amazing things. You gave them a new revelation, and I love new revelation, but let's not forget the old revelations.
Yes.
How do we begin to see the promise? Because until we can see with clarity the promise, pressure has the advantage. Mm-hmm. Give him a big hand clap. We're done. Thank you. Come on, give him a big hand clap. They've been standing for a while. So how do I begin to see, and that's where we're going to close out with this thought. How do I begin to see the promise? How do I see the joy that was set before me? How do I begin to set my focus where I can begin to tune in my spiritual eyes, if you will? And Jesus talked that way. Eyes, but spiritual eyes, but they can't see. Ears, but they can't spiritually hear. So that I can see the promise, so when pressure comes, not that I won't necessarily feel the pressure, not necessarily ignore the pressure, I can recognize it, but not be deterred by the pressure. Because some of us, and it's a growing phase, we hit a wall of pressure and we begin to go back. Yeah. Because I might not have the promise, but at least I'm not living with that pressure to get to the promise.
Right.
I'm believing for God to bless me. So God told me to begin to give and to give my tithes and offerings. And I gave my tithes and offerings, and you know what? I had a flat tire. Now I have an unexpected expense. I might not be blessed, but at least I'm not figuring out how to.
Come on.
And when we are in the pressure, we can, if we stick with it, having done all, stand, the Bible says. We will have what God has. Now that time frame is different for everybody. And it's based on your believing. It's based on your faith. It's based on what needs to die out in you. For Israel, it wasn't a long journey, but they went 40 years to the promised land, land of promise, until some things had to just move on. How do I begin to see? Have you ever got outside at night and looked at the stars? Maybe bought a telescope and looked up and saw the sky and tried to focus in on the stars. Scientists have these telescopes that obviously most of us are familiar with this. Telescopes that are just gigantic. That can see way beyond what we normally could see. So the stronger the lens, the farther I can see. Makes sense, right? The stronger the lens, the more clarity I can have for the things farther away. So the things that are farther away become, in appearance, closer. Scientists had a big article a few years ago they wrote, and in the context of light, light is the thing that is that was created by God. God is light, and it moves. Light has speed. Light has motion. And light, per science, is always in motion. They have come to the conclusion that creation happened within a twinkling of an eye, one article says. Although many will not yet concede that you have to have a creator to have a creation. It's like one guy going to a university looking for atheists that didn't believe in God, and he presented him a book and said, "What if I tell you this book that's got pages with information and ideas, that this was not written by anybody? It was not created by anybody. It just happened to show up on my desk one day." And most people would say, "You're telling me that that book was not created by anybody, and no one wrote that book with all the sentences and words and ideas and structure, that it just happened?" Yeah, that's what I'm saying. It just showed up in my house one day. No one ever made it, printed it, wrote it. It just showed up. And most logical people would say, that's impossible. The very fact that you have a book with ideas automatically shows you that you have an author. The very fact that it exists shows you that it has been created by someone. And then he turns the table and says, "So you're telling me that you don't believe in God?" "No, don't believe in God. But you're looking at all creation and you're telling me it just happened?" Doesn't the same level of logic have to apply, that if you have something created, you must have some creator? And so scientists, as they evolve, this is my opinion, as they evolve and learn and grow, it doesn't conflict with the Bible. It literally comes into alignment with the Word of God. And so scientists have found out that in a twinkling of an eye, that the universe was created and went in all different directions. They call it the Big Bang. I call it "And God Said." Because they can't come back the second before the beginning. What was there? What's at point zero before it started? Well, I don't know that. Well, I do. It's called God. In the beginning, in the timeless past, Genesis 1, God created. Did you hear me? I think it takes more faith to believe that the universe was by accident showing up than to believe that God created it. That's my opinion. You can like it or not like it. So scientists have figured that because of this situation, that they could take a telescope, and because light keeps moving, that the stronger the telescope, the farther they can see, and the farther they can see, the more they can see in our past. So the idea is that the stronger the telescope, they can begin to see the creation of everything. What am I telling you? That they're saying that the stronger the lens, the farther they can see, so far that it takes them to the beginning. Let me say that again. So the stronger the lens, the farther they can see, and they can get to the place that they can see so far, it takes them to the beginning. Hang on. I'll say it one more time, sir. The stronger the lens, the stronger the vision, the stronger the clarity of focus enables them to not only see far, enables them to see so far that they can see the beginning. Now, let me bring that into context of the Bible. How does that apply to us? And listen to me. This principle applies to each and every one of us. One day, God was talking to Moses. You got to love Moses. I know Moses, when I get to heaven, is going to sound like Charlton Heston. Moses. It just has to. And so God was talking to Moses, and Moses had a prayer request and said, God, I want to see you face to face. I want to see you in the fullness of your glory. And God said, Moses, I can't show you my fullness because nobody in the human flesh can survive if they see me in my goodness. That means God, let me, a side note, God is so good that you can't handle him. Literally. That's what Adam gave up. Of more than many things, but one thing Adam gave up was the inability to handle the weightiness of God's goodness. Because in the Old Testament, the word glory, the kabod, was the glory, the heaviness of God. God is so good that if you were 1 millisecond into the purity of his goodness, you would explode. Yeah. That's why you have to be transformed. That's why our physical bodies are going to heaven one day, because it's purchased by the blood and it has to be translated, it has to be transformed, because you can't stand in the weight of his goodness with carnality. It explodes. Okay. So God tells Moses, you can't see me in the fullness of my goodness. It can't, you won't survive. And he goes, but here's what I'll do. I love this. God said, there's a cliff by the rocks nearby. I'm going to put you there. I wonder how God did that. You know what I mean? Did he pick him up by the back of his shirt and did he just grab him? You know, I got a little parakeet, and sometimes if he won't come out, I'll just reach and grab him. And oh, somebody, it just lightened up as a joke. And so, I don't know how he got him. He goes, I'm going to put you in the cleft of the rock, and I'm going to cover your eyes, and I'm going to walk past you. And then when I'm passing you, I'll take my hands off, and you can see my backside. Now, I want you to notice something, that is very 2 or 3 dimensional for us, and it makes sense in the King James, and most of us think, just like we would, that I would cover your eyes and you get to see the backside. But that's not what's actually happening, because God is way more than 2, 3, or 4 dimensions. Right. Let me tell you, actually, and this, I'll put it this way, this is my opinion, you don't have to agree with me. That what God was saying, you can't handle my goodness in the context of a moment of eternity. You can't handle it. What I will do is I will cover your eyes and I will walk by and not show you where I am in the context of eternity, but I'll show you where I have been. Because you can't handle where I'm at, but the best thing I can do is show you where I have been. And when you understand where I've been, it begins to help you understand a little more who I am and where I am at, because I am the great I am. Okay. And I believe that's where, because Genesis was written by Moses. I believe it was in that moment of seeing where God had been, he received a supernatural download of how God started this whole thing. You say, what does that got to do with me? Let me give you another example of how this played out. You remember the story of David? Yeah. David was getting ready. He was just bringing food because his father asked him to the battlefield. He hears Goliath the giant, and he notices nobody is dealing with him. And so David's like, I'll take this guy on. What's the reward? Say, reward. Come on, talk to me, church. I'm going to work with somebody. You're going to walk out of here and have a redefinition of how you see the situation. What is the reward? What is the promise? He didn't go to battle without knowing the promise. Lester Sumrall used to say, never challenge a giant that doesn't have your milk and honey. That's good. Some people are just fighting everyone and everything. Why should I fight with you? You have nothing that's in my destiny. You have a right to choose who and when and where you're going to fight. And that doesn't mean you don't fight. Modern day New Testament Christians think that everybody should just love each other and kumbaya and hold each other. No, you have to do some war sometimes. But you don't fight just to fight. You fight where the enemy's rising up to steal your milk and honey. And so David says, what's the reward? Shout reward. I'm going long, but stick with me. We're almost done. What is the reward? And they said, and they gave him the reward. And he went into the tent of the king and said, King, Greg Bruce translation, King, your servant David will deal with this problem. Do you remember what he began to do? Then the king says, you're too young. You're not in the army. You haven't been trained. And he said, let me tell you why I'm going to win.
Right.
And what did he do? One day, O king, I was with my father's sheep and a lion and the bear. Took one, and I went after them. And I killed them and restored what belonged to my father. That's called reflection. Say reflection. Do you know what happens a lot of Christians when they get into a problem? This is what happened to Israel. When God delivered them from Egypt, you know what they kept wanting to do? Go back. Why? Because they never remember what God had done for them. And if you don't remember what God has done for you, you'll never keep pushing through the pressure to what God is wanting to do for you. David began to have a place of reflection. He's not denying the temporary. He's not denying the pressure. He's not denying the giant. He's not denying the storm. He's not denying the problem. He's not denying the bill collector. He's not denying the debt. He's not denying the lack. He's not denying the doctor report. He's not denying the situation. He's not denying the threat. What is he doing? He's reflecting where God has been. And in that reflection, in a moment, if you read it carefully, he goes from reflection to projection. Because after he says that, he then says to the king, King, don't worry. Just as those lion and the bear was to me, so will this uncircumcised Philistine be. Now he's prophesying. Now he's speaking a declaration of confidence about something that has yet to happen. Now he's saying, hey, God, the God who delivered me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear will deliver me. Reflection, projection. Reflection, projection. Reflection, projection. I'm just saying what I'm feeling. I'm just telling the truth. No, you're telling me the fact, not the truth. And the reason you're not telling the truth is you're not in the Word enough to get revelation of where God's been. Jesus said, if you keep abiding in my Word, then you shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free. As I'm spending time in the Word, I get an understanding, a clarity, and I can begin to see so far in the future, I can go to the past. Because he's the Alpha and the Omega. Reflection, projection.
Hallelujah.
What does the devil want you to see? Problem.
Right.
What does the devil want you to see? Pressure.
Yeah.
But if you can tell yourself, I'm going to give myself a 5-minute timeout, and I'm going to turn and begin to remind myself of the goodness of God.
Hallelujah.
Reflection. And in that reflection, guess what happens? You're going to have a moment where you turn and begin to say, wait a minute, devil. Matthew 18:18, what you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. What you loose on earth will be loose in heaven. You begin to speak to the mountain, and it will be removed. You can tell the sycamine tree, be uprooted and replanted. Why? Because you're projecting out of the reflection. You have a projection. Let me show one more verse. Can I give you one more verse? So he reflected, therefore, he reflected God's power in his past, therefore he can project God's power to his future.
Yes.
The more I see where God has been in my life, the stronger I and you and I will pursue where God is leading us in our lives. Here's the last verse. Ephesians chapter 1. It won't be on the screen. Let me just read it to you. Verse 18, and then we're going to skip. Paul is praying to the Ephesian church, and he prays that their eyes of their understanding, that the eyes of their understanding. Now you begin to see focus. Vision is all about understanding. That the eyes of their understanding would be enlightened. So there is a spiritual connection for you to see with clarity. That the eyes of your understanding, now notice the pattern being played out here, that the eyes of your understanding would be enlightened. And let me go right to the power, that you might know what is the exceeding greatness of his power to you, to usward, who believe. The exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe. What is he saying? I have so much power to bring you to your promise.
Yeah, hallelujah. Thank you.
But let me give you a mental picture of the power that I'm packing for you if you believe. What is that mental picture? What is that mental picture? He says, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ, come on somebody, when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in heavenly places. I'm giving you a picture of reflection so you can see what God by his power did in the past. Reflection, if you have nothing that God's ever done, if you just gotten saved, that's good enough. But if you're still questioning that, begin to look at the power in resurrection.
Yeah.
Because what he did in the past, he can do for your future.
Amen.
And when you begin to see reflection of God's power in your past, then you can turn with confidence and boldness and begin to have projection that the same power, death, hell, and the grave could not keep him back. When you deal with the strongest, the weakest back away. So Jesus went to death, hell, and the grave, and they could not deal with him. He made show of the devil openly. What? And that same power, same power. That same power in the reflection now can become part of your projection. That if he did that, I'm going to begin to set my affection, my focus on the promise. And it might seem like it's been a long time that I should have been to that promise before. And it seems like all hell is against me. It seems like everything is turning against me. When pressure builds, you have a choice to back away or keep pushing. I'll tell you a quick story, and I probably shouldn't tell you this publicly, but it is what it is. When we begin to move into negotiations for this space, okay, months and months and months and months of negotiating, praying, fasting, seeking God, feeling this is what God wants us to do, we are going through the process. Our bank came by to visit us. And so we're talking, and I said, he goes, so what's happening? I said, oh, we are in the middle of negotiating to move to a bigger space. Great price, great deal. I thought he would be excited. And he looked at me and said, well, that's interesting, Greg, but just so you know, we're not interested in that. We don't think you should do that. But you got to do what you think you need to do. But if just let you know that if you do proceed down this road, you'll need to let us know how you want to cover the note on the existing building. My friend, that is pressure. He said, we're not going to come in like guns blazing and foreclose on you, but we'd just like for you to tell us how you're going to pay the note off. Pay the note off. I'm trying to do better. We're trying to move ahead. And you should be excited. And if you're not excited, that's fine. But why are you being the enemy? That's pressure. And so I'm thinking, okay, I'm just going to leave it to Jesus. Not going to tell people. You never heard me complain about it from the platform. And then there was a big write-up in the paper how we're coming in. And I get a text the next day. Hey, Greg, just read the article. Congratulations. We need to get together. Let us know how you want to close the note out. And we hadn't started the renovation yet. We had only signed the legal contract that committed us. So now we are legally bound for 10 plus years. In a space, and someone is saying they're going to sink our boat before we can get into the next boat.
Come on.
And if that wasn't pressure enough, a few months of that, I get a phone call and somebody wants to meet with me, and they're looking to buy the building, and they don't want us here. So now I'm getting pressure from both sides. Someone's shooting behind me, and someone's shooting at me.
Yeah.
Come on, somebody.
Right.
Here, and I'm sitting there thinking, I'm second generation here. My dad pastored this church for 38 years. Oh, God, did I just blow the ship up? I could see my dad looking at me from heaven going, because it's hard to explain when pressure hits you. And you're like, is this real?
Yeah.
It's like, what do you do at that point? I definitely can't go back to the bank and say, can we get a loan for renovation? So that option's out. We just started walking, started standing, started believing, started expecting.
Yeah.
And there's the okay, there was days, many days, okay, God. But I had such peace on the inside. But it didn't mean I didn't feel the pressure. Because one's saying, we're going to take the church you have away from you. Yeah. One's saying, we're not going to let you get into the church you want to get into. What did we do? We just love people and love Jesus and love people. What's everybody so angry about? Have you ever felt that? I'm not bothering nobody. I'm trying to help people. What's everybody so angry at me about? Leave me alone.
Right.
I didn't ask them for something.
Yes.
Don't come in and try to put the brakes on. But when you're coming towards your promise,
yes.
And you know what now? The people behind us, they love us now. The people that was ahead of us trying to keep us out, they love us now too. They even did another write-up in the paper this week, talking about their future plans and how we are just one key part of this and for the future. Hallelujah. I love being loved. That's good. But I got to be willing to stand in the pressure to get to the place of promise. If you're here today and you thought about quitting, you thought about giving up, you thought about letting go, because the devil will tell you, is it worth the pressure? Let me tell you, the pressure doesn't stay forever. It's momentary. It has a beginning, and if you stand strong, it has an end.
Amen.
And if you can stand the test, because God's not creating the pressure. The pressure is because of the word. Stronger the pressure, are you listening? The greater the pressure, it doesn't mean that they don't like you. It just means the devil's afraid of you. Don't give in to the pressure. Begin to spend more time in the Word.
Yes.
And set your focus on things above, the promise.
Yes.
And when the enemy, when you have those days and you feel discouraged, don't quit. Because, are you listening? I'm going to close. I don't know who I'm speaking to. The devil can't make you quit.
Right.
If he could, he would have already done it at day one.
Yes.
Only you can decide. Don't be moved by what you feel, hear, or see.
Right.
Only be moved by the Word of God.
Amen.
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 We're done. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Would you bow your head and close your eyes? No one looking around. If you're here today and do not have a real relationship with Jesus Christ, I'm not asking you to join a church, denomination, or religion. I'm asking you this one question. Is Jesus Christ real to you? And the way you process, the way you experience, the way you look at life, is he real? He's more than an idea. He's more than a self-help and be a good person. He's more than a church, denomination, or religion, or a membership. It's the reality of who he is. Where you know without any question, shadow, or doubt that Jesus is real and that he's your Lord and Savior. If you don't, and only you can answer that, if you don't know him that way, you can. Revelation 3, he says, I stand at the door and I knock. If you hear my voice and open up, I'll come in. With every head bowed and every eye closed, I'm here to tell you that you can know who he is. You can experience freedom and liberty and salvation. The weight of the dark cloud that's been hounding your life can be eliminated. You can have a clear conscience between you and God. That weight of sin can be broken. And you could be free today. That comes out of a simple prayer. Romans 10 says, with the heart man believes and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Let's pray this prayer together. Let it come from your heart. Say with me, Heavenly Father, I turn to you today. I repent of all my sins. I believe in my heart and I confess with my mouth that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, that he came to this earth in the flesh, died on a cross for my sins, was buried for me, and on the third day rose again for me. Because I believe that, I ask you, Jesus, to come into my heart, wash me in your blood, forgive me, cleanse me, give me a fresh start. Say, Jesus, I don't want a religion. I want a real relationship with you. So I open up the door of my heart and life, and I invite you in as my Savior and my Lord. Thank you for saving me. Amen. Now, if you prayed that prayer, maybe you've prayed it before, or maybe this is the first time, and you say, Pastor, that prayer was for me today. Just so I know who I was praying with. I'm not here to embarrass you. I'm here to help you. I want to stand with you. And just so I know who I was praying with, at the count of three, all I want you to do is simply look me in the eyes and lift your hand as a way of letting me know I prayed that prayer. One, two, three. I see that hand. Second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth, ninth. God bless you. 10, 11, 12. Thank you. 13. God bless you. Anybody in the center? 14, 15. Over here to my right. 16, 17, 18. Anybody else? Anybody else? Amen. Come on, give the Lord a hand clap for every one of those individuals. God bless you. Amen. We have a couple gifts.